Hello guys, in this chapter I want to talk about articulation. Our skeleton can protect vital organs and support soft tissue. Its marrow cavity is the source of new blood cells. When it interacts with the muscular system, the skeleton can help the body to move. Bones are too rigid to bend, but they meet at joints that anatomists call articulations. In this chapter, I want to talk about how bones articulate and permit varying degrees of freedom of movement, depending upon both the shapes and the supporting structures of the different types of joint. The learning objective of this chapter is definition of a joint. Then I want to compare the structural and functional classification of the joints. And after that, I want to explain the inverse relationship between the mobility and the stability which we have for the joints. A joint or an articulation is the place of contact between bones, between bone and cartilage, or between bone and teeth. Bones are said to articulate with each other at a joint. The scientific study of a joint is called arthrology. Joints are classified by their structure and also their function. Based on their structure, we can talk about if there is a space in the site of attachment or not, and what type of connective tissue can fill this space. And if we want to classify the joint by their movement, we want to talk about the degree of the movement in each of the joints. The classification of the joints based on their structure are listed here. The first joint is called fibrous joint. In the fibrous joint, we don't have any joint cavity, and this joint occurs where bones are held together by a dense regular connective tissue. The other type of joint is called cartilaginous joint. This joint has no joint cavity and occurs where bones are joined by cartilage. And the last type of joint is called synovial joint. In the synovial joint, we have a fluid-filled joint cavity that separates the articulating surface of the bones. The articulating surface are enclosed within a connective tissue capsule, and the bones are attached to each other by various ligaments. And when we want to classify the joints by their function, we have three types of joint. The first one is called synarthrosis. The synarthrosis is an immobile joint, and we have two types of fibrous joint and one type of cartilaginous joint in this group. The other type of joint is called amphiarthrosis. In this joint, we have a slightly movement. One type of fibrous joint and one type of cartilaginous joint are listed in this group. And the last type of joint is called diarthrosis. This is a freely mobile joint. All synovial joints are diarthrosis. The motion permitted at a joint range from no movement, such as where some skull bones interlock at a suture, to extensive movement, such as that seen in the shoulder, where the humerus and the scapula articulate together. The structure of each joint determines both its mobility and its stability. There is an inverse relationship between mobility and stability in articulation. When the mobility of the joint increases, its stability decreases. In contrast, if a joint is immobile, it has maximum stability. And I want to show you in this picture. Look at here. In this picture, you can see the relationship between mobility and stability. Here, you can see the suture. The suture is immobile, but it's most stable joint. After that, you can see a slightly mobile, which is the stable joint, and we have most mobile, which is the least stable joint. And also in this picture, you can see three types of joint. One of them is cartilaginous. Their primary function is to resist compression and tension stress and act as resilient shock absorbent. They are immobile or slightly mobile, and you can see it in intervertebral joints. The other one is fibrous joint. Their primary function is to hold two bones together. They are immobile or slightly mobile. Examples of these joints are sutures and interosseous membrane. And the other type of joint is called synovial joint. Their primary function is movement, so they are all freely mobile. Example of this joint is glenohumerus joint between scapula and humerus, and also knee joint, which you can see in this picture. And now you can answer this question. What is the relationship between mobility and stability of the joint? And are all fibrous joints also seen in arthrosis? Explain why or why not. The first type of joint I want to talk about is fibrous joint. Articulating bones in fibrous joints are connected by dense regular connective tissue. We don't have any joint cavity. This type of joint is immobile or only slightly mobile. And we have three types of fibrous joint. One of them is called gomphosis. One of them is suture, and the other one is syndesmosis. First, about gomphosis. The gomphosis resembles a peg in socket. The only gomphosis in a human body are the articulation of the root of individual teeth with the alveolar process of the mandible and maxilla or jaw bones. A tooth is held firmly in its place by fibrous periodontal membrane. This joint is immobile and thus it's functionally classified as synarthrosis joint. And if you look at this picture, you can see the tooth in a tooth socket in the mandible or maxilla. And you can see that between the root of tooth and the bone, we have some light blue lines. All of them represent periodontal membrane as a dense regular connective tissue. The next type of fibrous joint is called sutures. The sutures are fibrous joints found only between certain bones of the skull. Sutures are functionally classified as synarthrosis, since they are immobile joints. Sutures have distinct interlocking, usually irregular edges that both increase their strength and decrease the number of fractures at these articulations. In addition to joining bones, sutures permit the skull to grow as the brain increases in size during childhood. In an older adult, the dense regular connective tissue in the suture becomes ossified, fusing the skull bones together. When the bones have completely fused across the suture line, these sutures are now called synostosis. So in this picture, you can see the sutures which we have between a skull bone. The sutures is a synarthrosis between the bone, and we don't have any movement in the sutures. And the last type of fibrous joint is called syndesmosis. Syndesmosis are fibrous joints in which articulating bones are joined by long strand of dense regular connective tissue, as you see in this picture. Here we have the bones in the forearm, radius and ulna. Between radius and ulna, we have a space. This space is called interosseous space. And this interosseous space is filled with interosseous ligament or interosseous membrane. This interosseous membrane provides a pivot where the radius and ulna can move relative to one another. So we have a slightly movement here. So functionally, we can classify this joint as amphiarthrosis. Now you can answer these questions. Where are gomphoses located and what type of movement do they allow? The other question is, what is the composition of a suture and where in the body you can find the sutures? And what type of movement is allowed at the syn desmosis? The other type of joint is called cartilaginous joint. Cartilaginous joint have cartilage between the articulating bones. Like fibrous joints, cartilaginous joint also lack a joint cavity. They may be either immobile or slightly mobile. The cartilage found between the articulating bones is either hyaline cartilage or fibrocartilage. The two types of cartilaginous joint are synchondrosis and symphysis, which I will show you the picture. The first one is synchondrosis. In the synchondrosis, you need to know that the bones are joined together by hyaline cartilage. Functionally, all synchondrosis are immobile and thus are classified as synarthrosis joint. The hyaline cartilage, which you can see between the diaphysis and epiphysis, is called synchondrosis. Here you see that here we have a piece of hyaline cartilage which can attach these two parts of bone. So here we have synchondrosis. And the other synchondrosis, which you can see, is the joint which we have between the first rib and the sternum, and also the costochondral joint between the rib and its costal cartilage. This is the synchondrosis, and you can see a piece of hyaline cartilage between two bones. In this picture, again, you can see the synchondrosis. Here we have epiphyseal plate, a piece of hyaline cartilage between two bones, and here you can see the costal cartilage, which you have it between the first rib and the sternum. The other type of cartilaginous joint is called symphysis. In the symphysis, we have pads of fibrous cartilage or fibrocartilage between articulating bone. The fibrocartilage resists both compression and tension stress and acts as a resilient shock absorber. All symphyses are amphiarthrosis. So we have a slightly movement between them. One example of symphysis is the pubic symphysis, which is located between the right and left pubic bones. In pregnant female, the pubic symphysis become more mobile to allow the pelvis to change shape slightly as the fetus passes through the birth canal. And the other example of symphysis are in the intervertebral joints, where the bodies of adjacent vertebrae are both separated and united by intervertebral disc. Individual intervertebral discs allow only a slight movement between the adjacent vertebrae. However, the collective movement of the intervertebral disc afford the spine considerable flexibility. We have a condition, we have a problem, which we call it costochondritis. Costochondritis is the inflammation and irritation of the costochondral joint, resulting in localized chest pain. The cause of costochondritis is usually unknown, but some documented cases include repeated minor trauma to the chest wall, or either bacterial or viral infection of the joints themselves. The localized chest pain may be mistaken for pain resulting from a myocardial infarction or heart attack. So we should have a diagnosis, a good diagnosis between the inflammation of the joints and the myocardial infarction. And the treatment of costochondritis is using NSAIDs, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like aspirin. With proper rest and treatment, symptoms typically disappear after several weeks. So not all of the chest pains are myocardial infarction. You need to pay attention to that. And now you can answer these questions. What are the composition of synchondrosis and where in the body you can find it? Into what functional category is the symphysis placed? Why it's in this category? And the next type of joint is called synovial joint. This is the most common joint which we have in our body. Unlike the joints previously discussed, the bones in the synovial joints are separated by a space which we call it joint cavity. Functionally, all synovial joints are classified as diarthrosis, because all are freely mobile. Often, the terms synovial joints and diarthrosis are equated. All synovial joints include several basic features. We have articular capsule, we have joint cavity, synovial fluid, articular cartilage, ligament, nerve, and blood vessels. And I want to show you the picture and talk about all of these parts. In this picture, you can see the synovial joint. Each synovial joint is composed of a double-layered capsule, which we call it articular capsule or joint capsule. Its outer layer is fibrous layer, and the inner layer is called synovial membrane. Here you can see the outer layer or fibrous layer, and then you can see this purple layer, which is the synovial membrane. The fibrous layer is formed by dense regular connective tissue. It strengthens the joint to prevent the bones from being pulled apart or dislocated. The synovial membrane, which you can see it in the inner part, is the specialized type of connective tissue, the cells of which help produce and secrete synovial fluid. This membrane covers the internal part of the joints, as you see here. But only the parts which are not covered by articular cartilage. These membranes can produce a synovial fluid. A synovial fluid, which is produced here, is a viscous, oily substance located within a synovial joint. It's a product of both the synovial membrane cells and the filter formed from the blood plasma. Synovial fluid has three functions. First, it can lubricate the articular cartilage on the surface of articulating bone. Then, the synovial fluid can nourish the articular cartilage's chondrocytes. The relatively small volume of synovial fluid must be circulated continually to provide nutrient to and remove waste from these cells. Because you know that the cartilage doesn't have any blood vessels. Whenever movement occurs at a synovial joint, the combined compression and re-expansion of the articular cartilage circulates the synovial fluid into and out of the cartilage matrix. And the third function of this synovial fluid is act as a shock absorber, distributing stress and force evenly across the articular surface when the pressure in the joint suddenly increases. The other part of joint is called articular cartilage, and you can see this articular cartilage on the surface of epiphysis. And this is a hyaline cartilage. This cartilage has numerous functions. It reduces friction in the joint during movement. It acts as a spongy cushion to absorb compression placed on the joints and prevents damage to the articulating end of the bone. This special hyaline cartilage lacks a perichondrium, because you know that most of your cartilages are covered by perichondrium from outside. Mature cartilage is avascular, so it doesn't have blood vessels to bring nutrient and remove waste product from the cartilage. And you know that the synovial fluid can compensate this avascularity. Only synovial joint houses a joint cavity. This is a joint cavity, and this is a space that permits separation of the articulating bones. The articular cartilage and synovial fluid within the joint cavity together can reduce the friction as bones move at the synovial joint. The other structure which you can see here is the ligament. Here you can see a ligament which is located in the outer part. The ligaments are composed of dense regular connective tissue, and they connect one bone to the other bone. Ligaments' functions are to stabilize, straighten, and reinforce most synovial joints. We have two types of ligaments. One type of ligament is called intrinsic ligament. The intrinsic ligament is actually thickening off the articular capsule. And the other one is the extrinsic ligament. It's located outside and physically separate from the joint capsule. The specific intrinsic and extrinsic ligaments are specific to each type of our joints. And inside the joint, we have numerous sensory nerves that innervate the articular capsule and associated ligaments. The sensory nerve detects painful stimuli in the joints and reports on the amount of movement and stretch within the joint. By monitoring stretching at the joint, the nervous system can detect changes in our posture and adjust our body movement. Synovial joints also contain blood vessels that provide oxygen and nutrient and remove waste. The other structures which we have in the joints are some accessory structures which can help our joint better. One of these structures are tendons. The tendons are like ligaments, and they are composed of dense regular connective tissue, but they are not part of a synovial joint itself. They can attach muscle to the bone, and they can help stabilizing the joint because they pass across or around a joint to provide mechanical support, and sometimes they limit the range of amount of movement permitted at each joint. The synovial joint also contains a structure which we call it bursae and the fat pads. A bursae is a fibrous sac-like structure that contains synovial fluid and is lined internally by a synovial membrane. Look at this picture. In this picture, you can see some bursae here. These blue structures are called bursae. They are sac-like, and inside the bursae we have synovial fluid. Bursae are associated With most synovial joints and they are located where bones, ligaments, muscles, skin or tendons overlie each other and rub together. In this picture, you can see the bone, you can see the tendon and ligament which pass on the joints. And these bursae are located between them to reduce the friction between these structures. Bursae may either connect to the joint cavity or completely separate from it. They can decrease the friction between these structures. The elongated bursae has a specific name, which we call it tendon sheet. Here you can see the sacs full of synovial fluid, but they are elongated. They are not small and round. We call them tendon sheet. The tendon sheets wrap around a tendon where there may be extensive friction. Tendon sheets are especially common in the confined spaces of the wrist and the ankle. The other structure which we have in the joints are called fat pads. And here in this picture, you can see these fat pads which are adipose tissue. Fat pads are often distributed along the periphery of synovial joint. They act as a packing material and provide some protection for the joints. Often, fat pads fill with the spaces that form when bones move and the joint's cavity change its shape. So you can see fat pads in a very mobile joints. We have some classifications for synovial joints. Synovial joints are classified by the shape of their articulating surface and the type of movement they allow. Movement of the bone at a synovial joint is best described with respect to three intersecting perpendicular planes or axes. One of them is called uniaxial. It means that the bones move in just one plane or axis. The other one is called biaxial, if the bone moves in two plane or axis. And the last one is called multiaxial or triaxial, if the bone moves in multiple planes or axes. All synovial joints are diarthroses. But some of them are more mobile than the others. From least mobile to the most freely mobile, we have six type of synovial joints. The first one is called plane. They have hinge. Then we have pivot, condylar, saddle, and ball and socket joint. And in this picture, you can see these different types of joint. Here you can see the pivot joint. This is the hinge joint, the saddle joint, the plane, condyloid or condylar, and ball and socket. And now I want to talk about each of these joints in detail. The first type of joint is called plane or glinding joint or plantar joint. This is the simplest synovial articulation and the least mobile type of diarthrosis. Anatomists have debated how to describe the movement of this joint with respect to perpendicular plate. We describe this type of synovial joint as a uniaxial joint because it usually allows only limited side to side in a single plane, and because there is no rotational or angular movement with this joint, the articular surface of the joint are completely flat. Example of the plane joint includes the intercarpal and intertarsal bones. the intercarpal and the intertarsal, sorry, joints. The joint between the carpal and tarsal bone. Look at here. In this picture, you see that the surface of the two bones are completely flat and they make joint and they can only move in one axis. So we call it uniaxial. The joint which we have between the acromion of the clavicle and the manubrium of the sternum is one of these joints. The intercarpal and intertarsal joint and the vertebrocostal joint and the sacroiliac joint are in this group. Look at this picture. In this picture, you can see the flat surface. You can see it in the carpal part or tarsal part. The next type of joint is called hinge joint. In the hinge joint, we have a convex surface of one articulating bone which feeds into concave depression of the other bone. Here you can see the convex surface and here you can see the concave depression. They go to each other and they can make a joint. Movement is confined to a single axis, like the movement which we have in the hinge of a door. So the hinge joint is considered a uniaxial joint. An example of the elbow joint, the trochlear notch of the ulna fits directly in the trochlea of the humerus, which you can see in this picture. So the forearm can be moved only anteriorly forward the arm or posteriorly away from the arm. Other hinge joints occur in the knee and finger. The next type of joint is called pivot joint. It's a uniaxial joint in which one articulating bone with a rounded surface, which you can see it here, fits into a ring formed by a ligament and another bone. This is a ring. You have bone and ligament, and this round structure, round projection, can fit in this ring. An example of the proximal radioulnar joint, where the rounded head of the radius pivots along the ulna and permits the radius to rotate. Another example of this joint is atlantoaxial joint, which we have between two cervical vertebrae. And you have it here. This is the atlas. Beneath it, you have axis. The dents of axis and the ring of atlas can make pivot joint together. Or in this picture, you can see the radioulnar joint between head of radius and head of ulna. Here you can see a ligament which can make a ring, and the head of radius can fit in this ring and it can rotate. The other type of synovial joint is called condylar or ellipsoidal joint or condyloid joint. This joint is biaxial joint with an oval convex surface on one bone that articulates with a concave articular surface on the second bone. Biaxial joints can move in two axes, such as back and forth and side to side. Example of condylar joint are the metacarpopharyngeal joint between the metacarp here and pharynx, which you cannot see it in this picture, and radiocarpal joint and the joint between ulna and carp. We have one oval convex surface articulating with concave surface, and this joint can move in two axes. The next type of joint is called saddle joint. The saddle joint is so named because the articular surface of the bone have convex and concave region that resemble the shape of a saddle. This biaxial joint allows a greater range of movement than either the condylar or hinge joint, the carpometacarpal joint of our thumb, as you see here, and the trapezium in the carp can make a saddle joint, and we can only see this saddle joint in this part of the body. This type of joint is biaxial, and we can move it in two parts. This joint permits the thumb to move toward the other fingers so we can grasp objects. And in this picture, you can see the bigger one. This is the trapezium of the carp, and this is the metacarp of our thumb. They can make a saddle joint together, like the saddle of the horse. And the last type of joint is called ball and socket joint. The ball and socket joint are multiaxial joints in which the spherical articulating head of one bone fits into the rounded cup-like socket of the second bone. Examples of these joints are the coxal or hip and glenohumeral or shoulder joint. The multiaxial nature of this joint permits movement in three planes. Move your arm at your shoulder and note the wide range of movement that can be produced. The ball and socket joint is considered the most freely mobile type of synovial joint, and this joint is the least a stable joint of our body. Here you can see the joint between the scapula and humerus at the site of shoulder joint, and the next picture can show you the joint between the hip bone and head of femur. And now you can answer these questions. What are the basic characteristics of all types of synovial joint? What is the purpose of synovial fluid in the joint? And what type of movement do each of the six kinds of joints allow? The next part is about movement of synovial joint. Four types of motions occur at a synovial joint: glinding, angular, rotational, and the special movement. And the first one is the glinding motion. Glinding is a simple movement in which two opposing surfaces slightly back and forth or side to side with respect to one another. In a glinding motion, the angle between bones doesn't change, and only limited movement is possible in any direction. Glinding motion typically occurs along plane joint, such as between the carpal or tarsal. The next type of movement is angular motion. The angular motion either decreases or increases the angle between two bones. This movement may occur at many of our synovial joints. They include the following specific types: flexion and extension, hyperextension, lateral flexion, abduction and adduction, and circumduction. Now, I want to talk about these different movements. Here you can see flexion and extension and hyperextension. This is again the flexion and extension. You can see flexion and extension and hyperextension, lateral flexion in this picture. What is the meaning of flexion? Flexion is movement in an anterior-posterior plane of the body that decreases the angle between the bones. Bones are brought closer together as the angle between them decreases. Examples are bending of your fingers toward the palm, or make a fist, the bending of your forearm toward the arm at the elbow, flexion at the shoulder. When the arm is raised anteriorly, the flexion of the neck when the head is bent anteriorly, and look down at your feet. The opposite of flexion is called extension, which the movement is the anterior posterior plane, and it increases the angle between articulating bones. Extension is a straightening action that occurs in the anterior posterior plane, like straightening the arm and forearm until the upper limb projects directly away from the anterior side of the body, or straightening the fingers after making a clenched fist. They are the examples of extension. And the extension and flexion is common in hinge joint. And in this picture, you can see the hyperextension. Look at here. This is the hyperextension, or this is the hyperextension. When a joint is extended more than 180 degrees, the movement is called hyperextension. For example, if you extend your arm and hand with the palm facing inferiorly, and then raise the back of your hand as it admiring a new ring on your finger, the wrist is hyperextended. If you glance up at the ceiling while standing, your neck is hyperextended. Flexion, extension, and hyperextension of various body parts are illustrated here. And the lateral flexion is here occur when the trunk of the body move in a coronal plane laterally away from the body. This type of movement occurs primarily between the vertebrae in the cervical and lumbar region of the vertebral column. The next type of movement is called abduction and adduction. As you see here, the abduction means move away, and it's a lateral movement of body parts away from the body midline. Abduction occurs when either the arm or thigh is moved laterally from the body midline. Abduction of either the fingers or toes means that you spread them apart, away from the longest digit that acts as the midline. Abducting the wrist involves pointing the hand and finger laterally, away from the body. The opposite of abduction is called adduction, means move toward. This is a medial movement of the body part toward the body midline. Adduction occurs when the raised arm or thigh is brought back toward the body midline, or in the case of the digits, toward the midline of your hand. Adducting the wrist involves pointing the hands and fingers medially toward the body. And you can see these two opposite movements here and also in this picture. Here you can see adduction and abduction. Here you have abduction and adduction. And also for our lower limb and fingers. The next type of movement is elevation and depression. The meaning of elevation is the superior movement of body part. Example of elevation include the superior movement of mandible while closing the mouth and movement of shoulder in the superior direction. And the opposite movement is called depression, is the inferior movement of the one part of the body. Examples of depression include opening your mouth to chew food and the movement of your shoulder in the inferior direction. The other type of movement is called protraction and retraction. The protraction is the anterior movement of a body part from anatomic position, as when jutting your jaw anteriorly at the temporomandibular joint, or hunching the shoulder anteriorly by crossing the arm. The retraction is the posterior movement of the body from the anatomic position. The next type of movement is called circumduction. The circumduction is a sequence of movement in which the proximal end of the appendage remains relatively stationary while the distal end makes a circular motion. The resulting movement makes an imaginary cone shape. This is demonstrated where you draw a circle on a blackboard. The shoulder remains stationary while your hand moves. The tip of the imaginary cone is the stationary shoulder, while the rounded base of the cone is your hand. And you can see it in this picture. The other type of movement is called rotation, and we have two types of rotation. Rotation is a pivoting motion in which a bone turns on its own longitudinal axis. Rotational movement occurs at the atlantoaxial joint, which pivots when you rotate your head to gesture no. Some limb rotation are described as either away from the median plane of our body or toward it. For example, we have lateral rotation here, and we have medial rotation. Medial rotation means turning inward, and lateral rotation means turning outward. The other type of movement is called supination and pronation. Supination means and occurs when the forearm rotates laterally so that the palm faces anterior or superior. In the anatomic position, the forearm is supinated. And the pronation is this: when you do the medial rotation of the forearm, so the palm of the hand is directed posterior or inferior. In this picture, you can see the flexion, the hyperextension, and the lateral flexion. In this picture, you can see the right rotation and rotation of head to right and left. In these pictures, you can see two specific type of movement. One of them is called dorsiflexion and the other one is called plantar flexion. The meaning of dorsiflexion is when the ankle joint is bent so that the dorsum of the foot and the toes move toward the leg. This movement occurs when you dig in the heels, and it prevents your toes from scraping the ground when you take a step. And the plantar flexion is the opposite movement, is the movement of foot at the talocrural joint, so that the toe point inferiorly. When a ballerina is standing on her tiptoe, her ankle joint is in the full plantar flexion. And the other types of movement are called inversion and eversion. During eversion, which you can see it here, the sole of your foot turns to face laterally. And during inversion, the the sole of your feet turns medially. So these are two other movements. Here you can see rotational movement. This is the rotation, lateral rotation and medial rotation, lateral and medial rotation, pronation and supination. We have a specific type of movement, which we call it opposition, movement of thumb toward tips of fingers at carpometacarpal joints. Enable the thumb to grasp object. And reposition is the opposite movement. And here you can see some special movement of our feet. One of them is supination of foot, complex combination of plantar flexion, inversion and abduction. And pronation of our foot is the complex combination of dorsiflexion, eversion and abduction. So you need to practice them to understand them better. Let me know if you have any questions in this chapter.